I've tried to keep a level head and just plot away, go game by game, but in my mind, I can't wait for the day when I can raise that Stanley Cup over my head.
We have a team that can win it, and we've believed that since training camp and all the way through the playoffs, and now right up to the point where we're actually four games away from the championship.
Our experience in these situations is going to come to the forefront, I think.
The last thing the Boston Bruins want to do is start going end-to-end with the Edmonton Oilers.
You want to accomplish something. You want to be a part of it, as big a part of it as you can.
We play this game to have the chance to carry that Stanley Cup around.
It's tough, it's hard, but it's worth every minute of it.
Time to remember the 1988 Stanley Cup Playoffs. Enjoying their finest postseason in a decade, the tradition-filled Boston Bruins were on their way to the 1988 Stanley Cup Finals. There they would face a team fast creating its own traditions, the defending champion Edmonton Oilers, winners of three cups in the past 4 years. The story of the road to the cup is part of the rich history of the National Hockey League. Stanley Cup 88 crystallized on the last night of the regular season as three Patrick Division teams contended for one final berth. The Devils could qualify with a win, but it would have to come against Chicago in an unforgettable overtime.
Back to the point, Joe Cirella. Cirella got in. Cirella takes a shot. Saved by Peng. Rebound. They did it! They did it! The Devils make the playoffs for the first time in their history. John McClain, the overtime goal. And they win it 4-3.
For 16 teams, the road to Stanley Cup 88 was now ready to begin. In the Patrick Division, it would be Islanders versus Devils, Capitals versus Flyers. The New Jersey Devils made their first ever playoff appearance against New York's proud Islander franchise. But in overtime of Game 1, as Pat LaFontaine scored the winner, New Jersey was quickly introduced to playoff adversity. But Jersey had beaten adversity all year, and the young Devils rallied to win three of the next four and take the series in a Game 6 that went down to the final shot.
Krejci in the middle. 2 seconds. 1 second. Shot. Oh, and that's it. Do you believe that finish? Do you believe that finish? The Devils have won. They have defeated the Islanders in the series, and they will move on to round two.
In 1987, the Philadelphia Flyers made it all the way to the finals, and the 1988 road to the Cup looked good as the Flyers jumped out to a 3-1 series lead over the Washington Capitals. But Philly lost its hold as the Caps became just the fifth team in league history to overcome a 3-1 deficit. And it took a thrilling overtime in Game 7 to cap it off.
Murphy starts the rush. He hits Hunter. He's in alone. A shot and a goal!
A clutch goal from Dale Hunter sent the Capitals into the next round against the surprising club from New Jersey. In the divisional finals, the amazing Devils pointed to another upset. After splitting two games, center stage in Game 3 belonged to Patrick Sundstrom.
Sundstrom coming right in on goal, a backhander, he scores! It is a new National Hockey League playoff record for Patrick Sundstrom, 8 points.
Sundstrom's cloudburst came in a 10-4 Devils romp. But rookie goaltender Sean Burke and company would find the next encounter very different.
Christian, a breakaway. The Devils caught the line change. A deke, a shot, and a goal! Dave Christian!
Washington came back to beat the Devils 4-1 and even the series. In their franchise history, the Capitals had dominated against New Jersey at the Cap Center. But this time in Washington, the Devils were due.
And gave it away to Muller. Walks right in. Muller to the backhand. He scores!
The Devils topped the Caps 3-1, but failed to clinch the series as the Capitals won again in New Jersey. That set up a climactic Game 7 at Washington. A 2-2 score until late in the third period when on came Jersey's Johnny on the spot, John McClain.
Back to the blue line to Craig Rolladen. Fires one that's tipped to score! McClain tips it out of the air. It's 3-2 Devils!
Stunningly, the Devils were moving on. The Patrick Division was theirs. The road along the Adams Division, always a rugged one. Canadians and Whalers, Bruins and Sabres. In these matchups, the hitting came early and often. In the Montreal-Hartford series, there were plenty of headaches. But the biggest pain the Whalers suffered was Stéphane Richer, who had 11 points in the 6 games it took the Canadiens to oust the Whalers. The Boston-Buffalo series also got physical. The Bruins popped the Sabres in the first 2 at Boston. But in Buffalo, the spotlight fell on John Tucker, whose penalty shot was one of 4 goals he notched in Game 3. The next night, Tucker tucked in 2 more, including an overtime game winner, to even the series at 2 apiece. But this series would belong to the Bruins thanks in part to nifty work from Rick Middleton, who dazzled in Game 5 and sparked Boston to take the Sabres in 6. Now for the Bruins, an old nemesis lay ahead. Tradition in the divisional finals. For Montreal, a winning tradition which included playoff mastery over Boston since 1943. In 18 series, over 45 years, the Bruins had never beaten the Canadiens. But now in 1988, with Reggie Lemelin in nets, Boston took that tradition head on. At Montreal, Lemelin's outstanding play in Game 2 salvaged a split. And in Boston, even the most fervent of Garden Loyalists were blessed with answered prayers as the Bruins streaked to 2 more wins and a 3-1 series edge, with the likes of Middleton, Lemelin, and Ray Bourque leading the way. Back in Montreal, the scene of so many heartaches was now witness to one of Boston's greatest moments. A 4-1 victory gave the Bruins the Adams Division and would send them further along the road to the Cup. Twists and turns through the Norris Division. Red Wings and Maple Leafs, Blues and Blackhawks. A passionate series between Toronto and Detroit, with combustion along the benches and plenty of fire on the ice. The Maple Leafs shocked Detroit in the series opener, but then dropped the next 3 contests. Although Ed Olczyk's overtime winner in Game 5 gave the Leafs hope, Red Wing firepower was ultimately too much. Detroit fans at the Gardens for Game 6 saw their club pick the Leafs apart with key goals from Bob Probert, Dave Barr, and Sean Burr. Red-hot Detroit was off and winging through the Norris Division. Meanwhile, the St. Louis Blues were facing the Chicago Blackhawks, who never quite got their game going despite the work of Rick Vibe, who tied a playoff record with 5 power play goals in 1 series. But that effort couldn't match the Blues' rising crop of youngsters like Tony Herkus, who scored 4 goals in 1 game, a first in St. Louis playoff history. More power came from late-season acquisition Brett Hull, whose 6 series goals helped the Blues hammer the Hawks in 5. A meeting of familiar foes in the Norris Division Finals. Jacques Martin piloting St. Louis against the Blues' former coach, Jacques Demers. In the opening pair, the Wings were on target, showing the style that set a franchise record for most goals during the regular season. Detroit won the first 2, but then dropped Game 3 at St. Louis. However, as the Blues tried to assert themselves, Detroit's stalwart defense turned the Blues and the series around with breakaway speed.
Klima's away.
Lead pass for Klima. Another breakaway for Peter.
He got it.
Red Wing fans were ready to say goodbye to the Blues in Game 5.
And Gordy Roberts goes back to get it for the Blues. Cleared it. Intercepted by Higgins right in. Higgins shoots. Scores!
Tim Higgins provided the series winner, and the high-flying Wings were celebrating their 2nd consecutive title in the Norris Division. quick moves and sharp turns in the Smythe division. Flames and Kings, Oilers and Jets. Against the Flames, the Kings dropped the opening pair on the road, but then took their best shot with a 5-2 win over the Flames at home. But this Calgary club totaled more points than any team in the league during the year, and ultimately the Kings were engulfed in a sea of red.
Kings are down 3-2, facing elimination if they lose this game. Hogan Loop takes it away at center ice. Loop shoots, he scores!
While the Flames were toppling the Kings, the other Smythe Division preliminary saw Dan Maloney's Winnipeg Jets achieve a victory of sorts. After dropping two at Edmonton, the Jets beat the Oilers at home, giving Winnipeg a first-ever playoff win against the Oilers. But Edmonton was not to be deterred. Playing with great passion, linemates Wayne Gretzky and Yari Curry led the way. It was Oilers over Jets in five, and that set up a provincial struggle better known as the Battle of Alberta. The last time the Flames and Oilers met in the divisional finals was 1986, when Calgary sent the Oilers to a stunning defeat. But this year, in Game 1 at Calgary, the Oilers served notice that this would be a very different encounter. Edmonton dazed their rivals with a 3-1 victory, keyed by 27 saves from Grant Fuhr. The second game at the Saddle Dome was a playoff classic. Terry Crisp's club was tied with Edmonton after two periods, but in the third, Hogan Loop set up Tim Hunter to give the Flames a 4-3 lead. Yet the Oilers came charging back.
It's a chance for Curry. Scores! It's all tied at four.
Yari Curry's goal sent this game to overtime. But 6 minutes in, the Oilers drew a penalty and were facing trouble. Though even then, they weren't exactly shorthanded.
Here he goes after the puck. He's played all night. Wayne Gretzky in on goal. Just scores in overtime. The winner, Edmonton win 5-4.
Taking two at Calgary, the Oilers were eager to resume against the Flame team that had knocked them off the top of the Smythe division for the first time in 7 years. So, back at home, the Oilers continued their mission. Though no game was decided by more than a two-goal margin, the Flames were swept in four for the first time in 14 years. The Battle of Alberta was over. The Oilers, a team with something to prove, were champions of the Smythe division and further along in their quest for another cup. Now the path had narrowed to two in the Clarence Campbell Conference. For the championship, Edmonton and Detroit. As the series opened, Jacques Demers knew his club would have to play its tight-checking style to the hilt. But for Detroit, the early returns weren't good. Edmonton took the first two games on home ice, displaying a potent combination of hard-edged determination and goal-producing unselfishness. When an opening was there, a scoring leader like Marc Messier made the most of it. Going down two games, the Wings could still look forward to a return to the friendly surroundings of Joe Louis Arena and to the return of their best player, Steve Yzerman, who had been sidelined with a knee injury for 9 weeks. In limited play, Yzerman helped lift the Wings in Game 3, as did two goals from Brent Ashton in a 5-2 victory. Now for the Wings, Game 4 would be critical. And in response, they got a great performance from Bob Probert, who scored two big goals. But Edmonton held its own, managing to send this game to overtime. That's when Grant Fuhr took over. Early in the overtime, Fuhr made a marvelous save on Probert, robbing the Wings of their best chance. At the other end, at 11:02 of the overtime, Yari Curry created a turnover and found the net to give the Oilers a tumultuous 4-3 victory. The return to Edmonton was far from pleasant for Detroit, as the Oilers out-hustled the Wings and gained submission.
It'll be held in by Muni. Muni slaps it in behind the Detroit net. Anderson wheels with a backhand save, rebound, and score!
Storming to an 8-4 win, Edmonton eliminated the Wings in five to take the conference. In 14 playoff games, the Oilers had won 12, never losing at Northlands. Now Edmonton would be returning to the finals for the fifth time in 6 years. Their goal? Defend the cup and bring it home once more. the Wales Conference Championship, a collision course being run by two upstarts, the Bruins and the Devils. Here were two teams peaking in confidence, two teams that would concede nothing to the other. The series opener was a back-and-forth affair decided by Boston's captain Ray Bourque, whose third-period goal spurred the Bruins to a 5-3 win and a quick advantage. But Game 2 would be closer through a dramatic overtime that Jersey made the most of.
Winding up, shot. Brown, score! They did it! The Devils win!
Doug Brown's game winner had evened the series. At the Meadowlands, Jersey's hopes were flying high. But in Game 3, Devils coach Jim Schoenfeld and his club were beset by penalties that gave the Bruins' power play a chance to strike.
Bourque sends a shot, score! They get the power play goal! Kuzak shot, score! They get another one! And it's a 2-0 Bruins lead.
Following an eventual 6-1 loss, Jim Schoenfeld lost his cool, and that set off an unusual sequence of events. Schoenfeld would be suspended by the league for one game, Game 4. But in unprecedented fashion, the Devils obtained a temporary restraining order in New Jersey State Court, prohibiting the league from enforcing the suspension that night. That, in turn, led to a wildcat strike by NHL officials and the use of amateur officials in Game 4. But when play finally began, the critical factor was the work of a rookie goaltender, Sean Bourque. The former Canadian Olympian was brilliant, as he led his team to a 3-1 victory. Now the series was even, and after the next two games were split, it all came down to Game 7. In the final showdown, a hero emerged. Once again, Reggie Lemelin.
There's Butler coming in off the right side as Verbeek open in front. His shot is blocked. Verbeek shoots. What a stop by Lemelin! Oh, my!
The Bruins took a 2-0 lead and added to it following an unusual faceoff.
Bourque takes the draw. Wins it. Quick shot! Scores! Ray Bourque to Rick Middleton! A wrist shot, and it's 3-0!
Yet the diehard Devils quickly rallied.
Cotton goes back to the net, centers in front, Muller shoots and scores! Kirk Muller! The Devils are within a goal of tying the Bruins!
But another Devil miracle would be cut short.
Steal by Jenny!
The Bruins had much to be thankful for in winning the conference title. They had prevailed in three emotional series. And though the road ahead was only getting tougher, Boston was going to the finals. 16 teams begin the Stanley Cup playoffs, yet only two reach the final round. As draining as the games might be, no one would forsake the opportunity to excel. The playoffs are a time to make the ultimate effort. And most importantly, for all who participate, they are a time to cherish.
This is the time to remember, 'cause it will not last forever. These are the days to hold on to, 'cause we won't, although we'll want to. This is the time, but time is gonna change. You've given me the best. Did you know that before you came into my life, some kind of miracle that I survived? Someday we will both look back and have to laugh. This is the time to remember.
Stanley Cup championship finalists, the Edmonton Oilers and the Boston Bruins. It had been a long and winding road, but now the destination for Game One was clear. Game day in Edmonton. Final preparation at Northlands for a Bruins club that prides itself on hard work. Yet this team has a different identity from the lunch pail gang of a decade before. Talented young players like Cam Neely and Craig Janney combine with a first-rate defensive core to make the Bruins a multifaceted team and road-tested Stanley Cup finalists. Meanwhile, the Oilers put their practice time to work. Despite the unquestioned gathering of talent in Edmonton, some critics had wondered ever since the season began whether this club, without the likes of a Paul Coffey, could repeat as champions. It was that question which these Oilers were intent on answering, noting the importance of team play and sacrifice. One example of that was Marty McSorley, changing from wing to defense just a week before the playoffs began. In any case, both teams knew what they had to do as two contrasting styles prepared to clash.
Turn the game quickly against them because they are such an offensive powerhouse that to really beat them, we have to be in that quick transition game and counterattack and play the game as much as we can in their end.
Skate, up-tempo, outplay. Our guys are really, you know, they expect so much out of themselves that they dare the other team to keep up with them.
Cut them down in the neutral zone as quick as we can before they get all the speed going.
When the puck's along the boards, you're gonna battle and battle and battle.
If the guy passes the puck, eliminate him.
And dare them to skate with us and play with us.
Really crunch people when you get an opportunity.
No retaliation, just one thought in mind, and that's winning the hockey game.
The battle for North America's oldest team championship, the Stanley Cup, is about to begin. In the pregame ceremony, there is a mixture of pomp, circumstance, and pride. In nets for Boston is the popular former Oiler, Andy Moog, playing against his old teammates for the first time. Grant Fuhr, considered by many the best goaltender in the world, goes for Edmonton. For each, a few quiet moments to shore up the composure before the onslaught begins. Defense results in a scoreless first period. And as the second begins, the Bruins find that they pick up a penalty for too many men on the ice. Boston had already killed two Oiler power plays, and it seems that this shorthanded situation might be even more successful as Ken Linsman breaks in alone. Fuhr's big play sparks another as Yari Curry heads up ice, setting up the Oiler power play and spotting Wayne Gretzky at the sideboards. Gretzky maneuvers, finds an opening, and heads to the net. First blood. The Oilers grab a 1-0 lead. For Gretzky, it was just a matter of being in the right place at the right time.
Well, I threw it back to the point and went to the net, and the rebound came to me. The net was basically empty, and I think I hit the defenseman's skate, or maybe the post, and then hit Andy in the back of the arm and went into the net.
About 11 minutes later, the Bruins find their way to break through with some smart passing that keys an attack.
Luzak back to Gutter. Now here comes Janney. Into Neely. Shoots! Score! Cam Neely ties this game up!
Passes from Kluzak and Janney and a goal from 22-year-old Cam Neely that finds the five hole. With that score, the game remains tied into the third period. Both coaches, Glenn Sather of Edmonton and Boston's Terry O'Reilly, know the next goal will be critical.
This is to Acton. Acton with Krushelnitsky. Krushelnitsky right in. Moog over. Back to rebound. That's blocked. Steve Smith shooting.
moment of joy for veteran Keith Acton, who later described how an aggressive Edmonton defense led to the go-ahead goal.
Our defense followed the play up real well all the time, and that opens, you know, holes in front of their net, a slot area, and I think Randy Gregg moved up, and I think he had a real good chance to score, and then because he was in there, you know, one of their forwards had to take him, and they got confused, and I ended up open at side of the net, and Steve Smith made a great play, great shot. I don't think he was shooting to score. He was shooting for me to deflect it.
Keith Acton had sat out the first 12 games of the playoffs, but now his timely goal is the difference. With few shots on net and the third period slipping by, the Bruins know they have to make a move. Relying on stingy, rock-solid defensive play, the Oilers shoot down the Bruin attack. A key effort comes from defenseman Steve Smith, as in this play where the blade of Smith's stick breaks up an almost certain scoring chance. Holding the Bruins to 14 shots, the Oilers take a 2-1 win in game one, and for the defending Stanley Cup champions, it's a 1-0 series lead. Prior to game two, the buzz of the crowd concerns itself with the change the Bruins are making in goal, going back to Reggie Lemelin. With a day off, the two teams have had a chance to make both mental and strategic adjustments as each team tries to anticipate the other.
In my mind, they don't want to get too offensive-minded because if it opens up, then, you know, we love to play that style. I think they have to be patient, and I think they have to, you know, play for their breaks, but I also believe that they're going to have to get Bork more involved and Telvin and Kluzek a little bit more involved in the offensive side of the game to be successful.
Against the Oilers, we were thinking, you know, don't let them score, which if you do that, you're going to be in trouble because they're out there and they're the championship team that they are, and they're going for the win, and they're going to make the play that's going to win the game. And so, you know, we have to change that sort of thinking, and we have to go after them and go at them harder, and we will.
The Bruins forwards surprised me somewhat. They kept the pace pretty well, and they didn't seem to tire, although their defensemen tired somewhat in the latter stages of the game. But the forwards kept up a pretty good disciplined pace, and I think it's going to be up to the Oilers to pick it up another notch to see if the Bruins can keep up with it.
In game two, for Edmonton, picking it up a notch means turning up the speed, a highly effective counterattack whenever the other team attempts to play the physical game, as Wayne Gretzky explains.
The most intimidating thing for a team who tries to intimidate teams is speed. And if you're skating and getting to that puck and taking that whack, they just keep saying, geez, I can't believe I hit that guy so hard, and yet, you know, nothing. I mean, we could send four lines and just keep coming in waves. And that's the philosophy we have.
Messier, center to Gretzky, wide open, Lemelin. Love save on Gretzky. Here's Anderson through the middle, Lemelin. Poke check. Comes in front, four feet through. Lemelin, a save from close in. And Lemelin keeps this game scoreless.
Reggie Lemelin held up through the Oiler assault. But late in the first period, the wear starts to show on the hard-pressed Boston defense. Gordy Kluzak was called for high sticking, and if that wasn't trouble enough, a minute 20 later, another penalty is also whistled on Ray Bourque. Now, as the Oilers begin a 5-on-3 power play advantage, Boston's two best defensemen are in the penalty box.
But Messier wins it to Curry. Over to Gretzky. Now to Tikkanen, back to Gretzky. Shooting, deflected, they score! Glenn Anderson deflects it in!
A penalty killer's nightmare. Playing two men down against Edmonton as pinpoint passing leads to Glenn Anderson's split-second deflection at the net. With the Oilers up 1-0, the Bruins again have to put their offense on hold when Reggie Lemelin's attempt to clear the puck actually clears the glass and lands in the crowd. That's a penalty. With 54 seconds left in the period, the Bruins take yet another minor, and that's trouble.
The last four times the Oilers have had this situation, a two-man advantage, they've scored. Here in the playoffs, here's Simpson to Tikkanen. Gives it to Curry. Side of the net to Messier. Now centered,
Knocked away by Lemelin. Held in by Curry. Here's Gretzky. Shoots.
The Oilers are right on their game, and Boston remains down 2-0 through two periods. But as the third period gets underway, the Bruins realize that they have to get something going. Not only are they on the verge of trailing in the series by two games, but even worse, they have not yet played their kind of hockey. Finally, in period three, that starts to change.
And breaking out is Janet. Over to Joyce. Joyce moves in. Shoots, he scores! Bob Joyce, the rookie, blasts one by Pure.
Bob Joyce's goal came only 35 seconds into the period, and less than 3 minutes later, Keith Crowder gives up his body at the blue line as the Bruins finally start to click in the Edmonton end.
Kicks it back to Talbot, into Crowder, now to LeMay. Out in front, Linsman, big save, Pure. Linsman scores on the rebound, and this game is tied.
Playing his pesky game, Ken Linsman receives a pass in the slot and then, left alone, makes the play on his rebound for the goal. Now the pressure shifts its focus. With the score still tied, both teams keep pressing, looking for a chance to strike. Finally, one team finds an opening.
Into the Bruins zone, but Wesley back to get it for Boston. He loses to Keegan and did.
Goal by Gretzky, with a big assist from a forechecking Esa Tikkanen, who cut off Glenn Wesley's pass and then instinctively found the great one heading for the net. At that point, Lemelin had little chance. This night, the Bruins have only been able to put 12 shots on net. But in the closing moments of the game, Boston tries to break through. In the last desperate seconds, Lemelin is pulled in favor of an extra skater, while the Oilers eye an empty net.
Curry crosses center. Oh! With 7 seconds left.
Final score, 4-2 Edmonton. With the Oilers up by two games, both teams now head east. The road to the Stanley Cup turns toward Boston, a New England seacoast city that takes very seriously its long-standing traditions of hockey and history. As the teams prepare for Game 3, attention focuses on the fact that the Oilers have a franchise record of 2 wins and 10 losses at Boston Garden. Some wondered if Edmonton would be able to open up on the smaller dimensions of the Garden ice. For their part, the Bruins were glad to be home. The return to Boston marked a new beginning. Yet it was quite clear the Bruins had no plans to make a turnabout in their proven style.
Starting tonight at 0-0 again, and for us to be effective, we can't worry about being in the penalty box. I know we got to do our best to stay out of there, but we still have to play the physical game, and if penalties result from that, we'll just have to kill them.
We expect them, in a traditional Boston Bruin manner, in their own building, the forecheck real hard, to dump the puck into our zone, the first man to knock the defenseman off the puck, the second man to crowd that corner, and even sometimes to have three men in the corner. They have a forechecking system unlike any other team in the league, where they just gang the puck, and they do it very well because of the small dimensions of their building.
Just the design of the building, you know, in the Garden, the people are really close to you, and the place will just be rocking. The crowd's really enthusiastic.
It makes it that much more exciting. I mean, the Boston Gardens, Causeway Street, Boston fans, it's all a special time.
The crowd in Edmonton was, you know, into the game, pretty noisy, but believe me, it's nothing compared to what you're going to hear. Pump up the volume. Pump up the volume.
Pump up the volume. Boston Garden was pumped sky high for game three, and so were the Bruins, who knew they had to put home ice to their advantage against the well-disciplined Oilers. From the opening faceoff, both teams had something to prove. Goal 2 minutes and 46 seconds in by Randy Burge stakes the Bruins to an early 1-0 lead. Minutes later, they have a chance to add another as Steve Casper wins a draw and heads to the net. Playing the puck off the boards, Casper just misses off the far post. The action continues back and forth, but later in the period, Edmonton presses in. Stuffing home a Gretzky rebound, Kevin McClellan ties the game. And a 1-1 score holds up through a fast-paced period of action. And with no let-up, the Boston turf war continues into the second period. At about 8 minutes in, Marty McSorley collides with Michael Telvin in what appears to be incidental contact. Woozy from the collision, Telvin eventually has to be helped from the ice. Meanwhile, the Boston bench is less than pleased with the incident. On the ensuing faceoff, Jay Miller becomes involved in a confrontation with Kevin McClellan, Miller receiving an extra 2-minute penalty. Thus, the Oilers now find themselves with yet another power play. Soon, Glenn Anderson gets the puck moving as Edmonton spreads it out. Working hard in front of the net is Esa Tikkanen. And as he occupies the Bruins' attention, Anderson takes a shot which bounces off Tikkanen for a goal and a 2-1 Edmonton lead. The Oilers' fourth power play goal in 16 tries has given them the upper hand and a chance to come at Boston the way they like, in wave after wave.
Simpson got it loose, set it up in front for Anderson. He scores! And it's 3-1 Edmonton. Gretzky in against center, they score! Gretzky to Tikkanen, and he was alone. The Bruins were sleeping a little bit.
Taking the game away from Boston, the Oilers enjoy a 3-goal lead in the third period. And aside from providing a comfortable margin, that Edmonton lead also helps take the Garden crowd out of the game. One touch remains. With 20 seconds left, Wayne Gretzky passes up an empty net to feed Esa Tikkanen. For Tikkanen, it's a hat trick. For Gretzky, a fourth assist. And for the Oilers, a huge step closer to the Stanley Cup championship with a 3-0 series lead. With the Oilers on track and one victory away from the Cup, the two teams take different approaches in assessing Edmonton's commanding position.
Well, you know, when you get a team down 3-0 and you've got them on the ropes, this is a time when they can be dangerous. They can come out. They've got nothing to lose now. Whereas game three, they had all the pressure on them. They were back home. They could get right back into the series. And now I think you'll see them come out in game four with reckless abandon and really try to take it to us and try to maintain that through a whole game.
There's no gloom and doom in our dressing room. You know, everyone's pretty relaxed. We realize the situation ahead of us, but we also realize, you know, we got to just take it one game at a time now and hopefully win tonight, force a fifth game, and you never know what can happen. As long as there's another game, you have another chance.
With Andy Moog leading the way, Boston takes the Garden ice determined to put forth an effort worthy of 64 years of Bruins history and tradition. But what has the makings of a gallant stand before the face-off looks like it might turn into a Boston nightmare, just in a matter of seconds.
Muni taps the puck ahead to center. Here's Anderson with a first big chance in the game. He scores! 10 seconds into this fourth game.
Stunning the Bruins and the crowd, Glenn Anderson and the Oilers have struck hard and quick. And life gets no easier for the Bruins, even when it appears to be going their way. An apparent goal by defenseman Reed Larson that might have tied this game is waved off because the Bruins were offside. And there's no disputing this call. The replay shows that before Larson brings the puck across the blue line, Nevin Marquardt has gone in slightly ahead of the play, and that nullifies the goal. In the course of the first period, the Bruins find themselves edging towards a familiar problem as the Oilers forecheck aggressively. First, Alan Peterson draws a holding penalty, bringing on the Edmonton power play. But the odds turn worse for Boston when Ray Bourque draws another minor. And for the fourth time in the series, Edmonton has a 5-on-3.
Gretzky on the blue line. The other side. Back to Gretzky. Gretzky. Here's the pass, the shot. Score! Had to happen.
That was Esa Tikkanen on another assist from playoff scoring leader Wayne Gretzky. And it puts the Oilers up 2-0. But late in the period, Boston's hard work finally pays off.
Stop. Middleton on it again. Good play. A good score!
With the Bruins dressing six defensemen this night, 19-year-old Greg Haugood was making his first appearance in the finals.
That's the youngster's first goal, and what a time to get it!
Born in Edmonton, Greg Haugood gives Boston a lift as he cuts the Oilers' lead to 1 with the first period near conclusion. But 5 minutes into the second period, it's questionable whether any Bruin momentum is carried over. Mo LeMay has drawn a penalty, giving the Edmonton power play a chance to open up again. On this tensely hot and humid Boston night, it looks like the Oilers are just picking up more steam.
Gretzky didn't show that. He circled back, hangs on to it. Plays it near the line and lost it. Wesley is away. Kevin Lowe back. Wesley, rebound, score!
Glenn Wesley, just 19 years old himself, turns a shorthanded situation into an opportunity with good fundamental defense, and then breakaway offense. As Wesley heads to the goal, Kevin Lowe gets back guarding against the centering pass. Feuer makes the first save, but Wesley pounces on the rebound. And this game, which looks so bleak for Boston, is tied. And the Garden crowd is pumped. With the temperature rising, the Bruins start to generate a little heat of their own. Shortly after Wesley's goal, the Bruins' power play gets a chance, a power play that has succeeded only once in 18 tries.
The crowd trying to get the Bruins up now. They might. Wesley shoots.
Wesley's second goal gives the Bruins a 3-2 lead, and it's the first time in the finals that Boston has had a lead after the first period. But the Bruins' excitement only adds to the heat on an already sweltering evening. A fog forms over the Garden ice surface as the rising temperature and humidity take their toll. Intermittently, time is called and the players are asked to help break up the clouds. Play resumes, but invariably, the eerie fog returns. Nevertheless, late in the second period, the Oilers find a way to cool off the building. Enjoying another power play, Wayne Gretzky leads an attack. Connecting on a deflection, Craig Simpson ties the game at 3 apiece, and in the midst of the Edmonton celebration comes the completely unexpected.
The emergency lighting here in the Boston Garden.
What else could possibly happen?
Yes, this night the lights were out to stay at Boston Garden. For safety reasons, the players were cleared from the ice, the fans from the building, and the game, according to league bylaws, would be canceled.
If for any cause beyond the control of the club, a playoff game should be unfinished, such game shall be replayed in its entirety at the end of the series, if necessary, and it shall be played in the rink in which the unfinished game occurred.
Back in Edmonton, both teams were reflecting on the unusual turns the Stanley Cup road had taken and what still lay ahead.
It was a strange thing, and it was a strange day yesterday coming here. And, you know, it's like the good news, we're going to Edmonton. The bad news is we're still down 3-0.
We went into Boston hearing so much about the Boston Garden, the small ice surface, how tough the Boston Bruins were going to play. And those were factors that we had to face and we had to overcome. The lights going out was, it kind of brought a smile to our face, a little more adversity, something else that it was a challenge we had to meet.
You know, if we win tonight, things can change, because all of a sudden we got 2 of the last 3 games in Boston, and that's a big difference.
We have a tremendous amount of respect for them. We really believe that they can play very good hockey, that given the opportunity, they're going to score a lot of goals and do a lot of things. We believe we have to stop them from doing those things.
There's a general looseness to us that we're, you know, we want to go out and just lay it all out, put it, you know, lay it all on the line and give it everything we got.
If they want to open the game up, by all means, let them do it. You know, if they're in our building now, especially if they try to open the game up, we'll up the pace and play with them at such a pace. And if they manage to score 2, well, hopefully we'll score 5, because I think that's our type of hockey game.
The Bruins felt that Game 4 in Boston had been their best showing of the series, and they were looking to build on that. While the Oilers remembered that all 3 of their previous cups had been won at home. This night, they were looking for number 4. At Northlands, the contrast was clear. One team fighting to keep hope alive, the other looking to finish the job and reclaim the championship. As the game began, the Bruins pressed their case.
And Burridge takes it for Boston. Burridge brings it back in. At the line, gets a shot. That was blocked by Smith. Burridge centered it. Score! Casper was open, and he fires it by Grant Fuhr. And it's 1-0 Boston.
Embodying the Bruins' never-say-die spirit, Steve Casper scores from a difficult angle. And 43 seconds into the game, Boston has the advantage. But if there's one thing the Oilers have learned this year, it's patience. And that pays off as Craig McTavish wins a draw. Low passes to Craig Muni, and he gives to Norman Lacombe. And that quickly, the game is tied. Providing a boost from the third line, rugged right wing Norm Lacombe has evened the score and set the stage for some more hard-fought hockey. In the course of the action, a penalty is assessed on Esa Tikkanen, and he's soon joined by Mark Messier. Now the Bruins have a 5-on-3.
Now coming out, Bork plays it to center to Lindstrom. Lindstrom rolled it into the zone. That is Greg going back. Played back to the line to Bork. Bork to the side of the net to Lindstrom. Lindstrom gets ready. He shoots. That's not the score.
A determined Ken Lindstrom, Boston's leading playoff scorer, connects on his 11th goal of the postseason, and in so doing demonstrates how the Bruins like to jam the net to create their 5-on-3 opportunities. Full of twists and turns, this game's tempo and intensity continue through the first period. But as the Oilers make a rush, Keith Crowder draws a penalty at 13:29. With the score 2-1, the Bruins need to kill yet another power play.
Pascal right under the stick of Middleton. He just skates down the ice with it, now loses it. Tikkanen moves it up to Gretzky. Tikkanen go in with Anderson. Gretzky back to the line of Curry to Gretzky. Back to Curry. He slapped it. Stopped his goal.
With his 5th goal of the Stanley Cup Finals, an alert Esa Tikkanen finds the net off a Bruins skate. And this seesaw battle is tied 2-2 as the first period draws to a close. The focus is on Grant Fuhr at the beginning of the second period. As expected, the Bruins come out flying. But when called upon, Fuhr is ready, and he responds brilliantly, just like he's done throughout a year in which he set a league mark for games played by a goaltender. In quick fashion, the Oilers get their forechecking game going with Acton, Krushelnicki, and McClellan. Soon, ex-Bruin Mike Krushelnicki finds the net, and the Oilers go up 3-2. There was little Andy Moog could do as Krushelnicki knocks it home. Now leading by a goal, the Oilers up the pace and the Bruins are hard-pressed to keep up with it. Another penalty on Boston, and the Oilers look to break it open.
Tikkanen waits here at the blue line. Now hands it off. Tikkanen again takes it. Winds up, fires, like the Gretzky scores!
Leading his club by example, Wayne Gretzky puts Edmonton in front by two. After receiving a pass from Tikkanen, Gretzky takes the puck off his skate for the goal. It's a playoff-leading 42nd point in 19 postseason games for the great one. Still, the Bruins keep coming, but Boston announcer Fred Cusick describes what they face.
Trying to get it in the zone. Lindsman breaks over the line. He's moving in. He shoots and a save. Oh, what a chance. Neely fights, keeps it in. Neely cutting, shooting, hit the post. Oh, what a cut play. Bruins trying to come back now. Over the line. They move it for O'Dwyer. Shot and a save. And let me tell you, Fuhr is the guy who gets the championship for Edmonton.
And with little time remaining, number 99, Wayne Gretzky, checks the clock and makes every second count.
After the period, as he hits center, in across the line, Gretzky, you're in front, score! Wow, 2 seconds left.
Craig Simpson deflected Gretzky's lead pass to put Edmonton in front by three. And the young Oiler later described this masterpiece worthy of a champion.
I yelled at Gretz that we had 11 seconds left, and we all came up on the play, and we got to their blue line. He made a great play by cutting across. He just slid it through 3 or 4 inches in the air, and I just batted it down. And boy, when I saw it go in and looked up at the clock and saw there was still time left, it was a great feeling, and I think it knocked them down a few pegs going into the dressing room, suddenly down 5-2 as opposed to 4-2.
The Bruins have little choice but to open it up completely as the third period begins. But the Oilers are ready for that with a little help from a fortunate bounce. Esa Tikkanen with his team-leading sixth goal of the finals, and the Oilers are now up 6-2. The celebration has begun, and though the Bruins add a goal, the countdown is just a matter of time. For the fourth time in 5 years, the Edmonton Oilers savor the joy that comes only with winning hockey's greatest prize, a joy that comes with a sense of ultimate accomplishment. For both teams, mutual respect and appreciation. And though no one knew it at the time, for Wayne Gretzky, a final and most memorable triumph in the uniform of the Edmonton Oilers. In 10 incomparable years as an Oiler, Gretzky played the game of hockey at its highest level, bringing the greatest possible distinction to his team, his city, and his sport. Fittingly, in this time to remember for all time, the Conn Smythe Trophy is awarded to Wayne Gretzky, indeed the most valuable player. But Gretzky would be quick to say it's all secondary to the honor of hoisting the cup, and that's a privilege to be shared by every Oiler who was a member of the 1988 Stanley Cup champions. The Oilers played a team game, and above all else, this was a team victory. In this time of celebration, the Edmonton Oilers, winners of 4 Stanley Cups in 5 years, now take their place among the greatest teams ever assembled in the history of the National Hockey League. The 1988 Stanley Cup Playoffs, a time to remember. This was a time of excellence and achievement.
The Edmonton Oilers players now put team first and foremost ahead of anything, and it has to be that way. And hopefully the new guys are learning that any personal satisfaction you might receive, any of the recognition, the notoriety, the exposure, all centers around a team victory, centers around team accomplishments.
Nothing else in my mind mattered except what was happening then. And it was such an emotional feeling picking that up over my head and walking around the Coliseum. And all the hard work all year, all the little things that the whole team had been through, the ups and the downs, and suddenly there's the cup, there's what we've been working for. The season's over and we've won our last game. And all that feeling of satisfaction and gratification just comes flowing into you at that point.
Looking at Messier and Gretzky and Fuhr, and Anderson and Curry and Lowe, and you've got to look back on it years down the road and say, this hockey team was a tremendous hockey team. You know, playing last year in the Stanley Cup Finals, and to look at the team picture now and say, you know, I was honored to play with those guys.
This is the time to remember. Did you know that before you came into my life, some kind of miracle that I survived? Someday we will both look back and have